Beat is so fucking whimsical.
That, my friends, is the alert that Midway Radio is back.
It's your boy.
I don't think we have had anybody freestyle over that yet.
Really?
No, not yet. But it sounds like we're about to. Hey, you guys may know him as a DJ. You guys may know him as a producer. You may even know him as a creative designer. You guys, we're going to be talking to Steve Bravo.
Bravo.
You forgot breakdance therapist.
Breakdancer, you know, we have a certain amount of time. We can't live out everything you do. He's like, I make a hell of good grilled cheese sandwiches and Welcome, Steve. Welcome to Midway Radio. It's a lot like the 80s, but instead of one hit wonders, we have DJs. DJ is like DJ Sean Doe.
What up,
Welcome. DJ Risky Business.
Oh yeah, what's up? I'm the DJ that owns more movies with more hours than I have to live.
DJ Risky Business, the only person that I know that interrupts himself.
Bunch of fucking comedians.
Hello, Ryan Brockmeyer is back. Yay!
What up? Hello, everybody.
You guys, Steve Bravo's here. Steve, any relation to Johnny?
Yes, that's my dad.
Perfect. I can tell. You guys look spitting images.
We have the same hair, but take the hat off.
So listen, over the weekend, I went and hung out with Doug M, and you guys were sitting over there showing all your toys and stuff. I just wanted to show you, I got a patch.
Oh, shit.
And then I got another patch.
Wait, hold on, what the fuck, hold on, man.
Whoa, pause.
For those who are just listening to the podcast and not actually watching, we have somebody eating popcorn and trying to talk while food is in his mouth.
No.
So while we're at it, why might as well show you that one?
That is not popcorn, you dick.
Whoa.
Either way.
Are you saying it's not popcorn? It's what?
You said it's on?
Yeah, I got this one too. I got that one too.
That's what I heard.
And then I got that one too. And then I got that one too.
Yeah,
And then I got that one.
God damn it. He just did a damn thing.
Yeah. Oh, and then I got that one. Oh, and then I got a whole bunch of stickers and stuff, which, speaking of which, you know.
Oh, and then
got some Doug Imp stickers.
Oh shit.
Oh, and then the Peace Day Resistance. Howard the Duck up in this bitch. Boom.
Oh god.
Doug started flipping patches at me. He said, "Tell me when to stop." I was like, "When you run out."
Nice.
Look at that.
Say something, Ryan.
Howard the Duck, the movie on Blu-ray.
Boom.
I have that.
I love it. So, shout out to Doug for hooking me up. Now I have to figure out what I'm going to do with these patches. I was thinking like a hoodie or something. Just go.
One hoodie with all the patches?
Yeah. Yeah, including the Doug Imp patch. So there, that's all I got. You guys, Steve is here.
Well, the show's over now.
All right. Thank you, guys. I appreciate it.
How are you
doing,
sir?
What are we talking about today? I'm doing okay. I'm trying to stay awake, but I'm okay.
Have you guys started asking questions yet?
No, I was wondering if Chad was going to say something, but I think he's too busy eating grapes.
That might be the wrong way.
Yep. Grape eater.
They're great.
So,
Steve, my.
What's up,
bro? So, I talked to you a little earlier about, like, you know, just kind of like the show. The show is just pretty much, you know, we just talk shit for about an hour. But
I can do that.
What like, I know you did some things back in the day. I mean, we want to talk about present time because present time is pretty dope. But I heard you used to DJ.
Really? That's a rumor.
Yeah.
Have you seen pictures of that? A video or anything?
Yeah, I've actually seen a picture, but I text you, and and you were like, "No, that's not me." I sent it to Darrell. I said, "Darrell, this is Steve." He said, "Yeah, that's Steve." I said, "This motherfucker told me that it wasn't him." I know it's him. So, yes, he used to DJ.
When did you start? I did not everything. When did I start DJing? Oh, that's a good question. Shit. Maybe 90. Oh, God damn it. Officially, like, all right, when you say start DJing, do you mean start training or start working?
Well, when was your first DJ paycheck?
My first DJ paycheck was, motherfucker. I was, you know what? My first DJ paycheck was, I got paid. I don't want to call it a check. It was like a, I was DJing for, you remember Chicago Party Masters, Diego?
Yeah.
All right. So the first time I got paid to DJ was in St. Louis. It was a show. It was OC. It was Killer Army. It was Ice Down Medallions. What's his name?
Royal Flush.
Royal Flush and somebody else I can't remember. And Darrell was hosting, and JR was there, but JR didn't feel like DJing, so he let me go on. Now at this time, I had no DJ hours put in or anything, so it was a fucking mess.
Yeah.
Did it was fucking terrible.
Or did the crowd think it was
a mess? We all agreed it was a mess. It was unanimous.
But at least you got paid for it.
Yeah, I got a few bucks. So it wasn't, you know. But I think that's where actually the DJ thirst didn't start there. It started way before that. But that's when it officially was like, wait, I could do this and possibly make a few bucks. Okay. I'm in. I'll do it. Fuck it.
What made you want a DJ? Like, all right, so we talked about your first paid gig, but what, like, what made you want to start DJing? Like, what song was it or what, like?
It was definitely, I'll tell you, I can tell you when I bought my first record. Mm. And that was 19, I used to live in Uptown. So it was a record store on, next to this pizza place called Gigio's. I can't remember the name of the record store, but it was my first record that I ever bought was a 45 of Miami Sound Machine, Dr. Beat.
Boom. Nice.
But then after that, I was always into hip hop, but after that, I just started, I'm like, wait, I can buy LL Cool J, I can buy Run DMC, Fat Boys, blah, blah, blah. So I just started buying records, and I think I was maybe 12 at the time. So I've had it in me. Like, I knew I liked records. I knew I liked music. I knew I liked hip-hop. It's like, okay. When I first started DJing, I wanted to I wanted to play house because that's what I grew up on, house and, you know, all the old shit. But hip hop just took over.
So did you, I mean, you said you wanted to play house. Was it something that you like?
Because that's when I first experienced DJing was house music.
I think it's fair to say that I think most people in Chicago, even almost all the hip hop DJs, experienced DJing through house first.
Absolutely.
Especially the time that we grew up. I mean, house owned Chicago.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. And especially in the 80s. I can remember the first time I saw a DJ play house music. I was at a school on the south side called Mendel. It was a Catholic school, and they used to throw these parties on the weekends. My cousins took me down. I was maybe 11. But I've always had a mustache, so I can get it anyway. So,
what's that for you? Like, I still can't grow one.
I've been born with a mustache. But I, the first DJ that I saw play live house music, records, vinyl, was Ferris Thomas.
Okay.
And like that had to be 80. Oof, I'm gonna say 83.
Wow.
Yeah, and that shit like that shit just blew my mind.
So that was definitely probably, that was obviously early house. So it was a lot of like early tracks and probably a lot of disco.
Yeah, but it was mostly, I mean, at this time it was like, I mean, it was just acid track heavy.
Acid tracks, yeah.
Oh my God, that shit was hypnotic.
Yeah, it's funny, like house was house, but it's, and it all kind of gets thrown together a lot of times, but like it was definitely house music wasn't even really house yet. It was acid almost. Most everything was that acid sound. And it's funny how acid has a name, but everybody just kind of called it house music. It was the first like real sub genre of it, but it was the most powerful one in Chicago at least.
Yeah, that shit was emotional. Like I mean, and later when I was in high school, I go to, you know, all the places like, you know, Warehouse, Sawyer's, Music Box, all that stuff, and like seeing the crowd's reaction to house music was just crazy. It's like I'm too young to be seeing shit this sexy. Like it was crazy. Like, it messed me up.
You were talking about the first party that you saw a DJ at was at Mendel. Could you talk about how the Mendel party was?
It was, man, my memory is bad. I can tell you what it felt like.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was hot. Imagine being in just like, you've seen videos of like the Japanese train system at like rush hour.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So these parties were like that, like people were that close to each other. But it was like everybody moving at the same time, and just like the room had like a, I don't know, it's like the room was alive. It was the craziest shit. Sweat coming down the walls. It was insane. Like now thinking back, hygiene wise, that was probably not a good experience. But when it came to just being in there and feeling that energy, that was, man, it was nothing like it.
Unmatched.
But it was definitely nasty. And it was, yeah, it wasn't. It wasn't nasty. Pleasant once you left and you were drenched and your sweat and other people's sweat.
So yeah. I'm too young to remember parties at Mendel's or St. Martin de Porres.
Oh man, you're younger than me. Get out of here.
But I'm not old enough to remember that, but I'm old enough to remember seeing those people go to those parties because I live right there on 111 King Drive. So
you were right there,
I could look out my house and watch people go. So that was one of the things when I was a kid, I was like, man, I'm like, that has to be bananas, because I would see the women that would go there and I'm like as a kid, I'm like, oh shit. Like,
yeah, even at 11 I was like, I don't know if I'm supposed to be seeing this is, mm-hmm, what is this? It was a different world. Like it was it was like going to a different planet. Seriously.
Yeah, but that's kind of the magic of that time and that era. I don't think, you know, I would be hard pressed to say that anything like a party like that can be matched. You know, I would love to find it.
No. I mean, I have seen a lot of, I've been to a lot of parties. I've seen a lot of shit that had the same feeling. I've seen hip hop parties that have had the same feeling. Shit. I mean, Red Dog had the feeling. Dog had the same fucking feeling.
Did you DJ at Red Dog?
Did I DJ at Red Dog?
Can you talk about
did you
this is called segue.
Did you do research? Yeah, he did it. Yo, Red Dog, let me tell you, Red Dog was the dopest shit I probably ever have partied in my entire life. Like, that shit was insane because I was just becoming a DJ, kinda. Like, I had some, like, residencies and stuff like that, but Red Dog was training. It was like going to boot camp because number one, I got a chance to DJ with the two dopest DJs in Chicago, one of which I think is the dopest DJ on planet Earth, 33 and a third, and Twilight Tone. Like, who the fuck gets to DJ with two of the, with those two every Saturday for 4 years?
Wow,
that shit was boot camp. That shit was
crazy. They're both pretty equal. 33 and a third is the greatest party rocking DJ I've ever seen because he brings in every. Not only does he know how to rock a party, but he's the most fucking technically sound DJ that rocks parties.
Oh my
god! There's a lot of amazing like trick battle DJs. But they're kind of one trick ponies, no pun intended, because that's kind of their thing and they don't really rock parties.
No, not at all.
33 and a third could do anything your favorite DJ could do better and rock a party better.
Like, honestly, I have to say 33 is my, and I don't want to offend any of my DJ friends, but that's my favorite DJ the world.
I doubt it. Your DJ friends should respect that so much, they should be like, yeah, that's my favorite DJ too.
Yeah, that's exactly.
I've never seen some of the shit I've seen him do. I've never seen anybody do.
There's no way
it's amazing. You can't even, like, if you talk about somebody that was, he had no choice. He was born to be a DJ. He was born to be a DJ.
33 and a third might be a top 10 greatest DJ to ever live on planet Earth. Cause I would put him up against anybody. And I mean, there's probably some, and I think every city has a 33 and a third. That's a dude that is the only thing that stopped 33 and a third was his humbleness. That's the only thing that kept him from being, cause if he had the fucking cocky attitude that some of the other DJs who are way, way less dope, but had more pub and press because that was their thing. If he had that in him with what he does, he would be Funk Flex. I mean, popularity wise.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, even bigger than that.
Yeah, even no, I mean, that. He would be, he's but just, yeah.
To speak to his humbleness, first of all, I mean, we've had a lot of conversations over the years. He's not as humble as you think he is. And then,
well, yeah, no, I see what you're saying. I know around his people, yeah, he know because he knows what he is. I'm just saying, as far as like he's a quiet dude, you know, he's not gonna
publicly aware.
Yeah, he knows what he is, and he's just quiet about it.
Yeah, and but his humbleness is what helped him though. Like, he's not somebody that has ever burned bridges or. He's never done bad business, you know. He's rare.
Yeah,
you know. Yeah. I don't think he really had any DJ trouble at all.
No, I think he's a perfect role model for what a DJ should be and what should strive to be.
What do you mean by DJ trouble?
You know, DJs are shady. Come on, man.
Okay.
You know.
We may or may not know. We want you to tell us.
DJs are shady, and it's not because they have bad intent. It's something about creative people that they don't have the same vibrations as everybody else. They're not on the same wavelength. So it's some things that creative people just don't understand about non-creative people and how to deal with them. So I mean that's something that you learn through practice and through just constant intermingling with, I hate to say regular or normal people, but that's the only thing I can think of. Like normal people, like you have to understand their ways. They're like, we're like two different alien races occupying the same space, and it's really difficult to communicate sometimes.
I agree with that.
As a creative person, to somebody that's not necessarily in their headspace.
Creatives are more like, you're more apt to find a creative where it's hard on his sleeve, be more emotional and different things like that. And I'm not saying from a weak standpoint, I'm like, that's just what it is, because
that's what we it is.
Constantly pour our souls out in some art form, whether it's painting, design, DJing, producing music. And some of us, Steve, do every fucking aspect of that.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And it's a thing as a creative that you have to just get that shit out of you, or it festers in you and makes you sick. In fact, I think for me, if I don't get, no matter how it comes out, whether it's good or bad, if I don't get it out of me, it can become almost depressing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely. And that's why a lot of creative people feel this, like this depression. It comes in waves. Like, I get it sometimes, you know, I fight it a lot, but it's all, I have so much that I want to get out, and I can't get it all out at the same time because I'm only one person. So I feel like I'm failing if I don't get it all out at the same time. And that takes me to a dark place.
Yeah. And it's funny because I don't know if you feel the same way. I'm not concerned of how, the one thing I think that I feel lucky, I guess, and like a blessing is, I'm not concerned how people, I mean, of course I want people to like my shit, but I'm not overly concerned how people receive it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just, and I just do my best. I know I'm going to do my best no matter what. I just have to get it out of me. If you like it, word up. If you don't, cool. Maybe you like the next thing. I mean, I know some people, I think one of the problems creatives have is they have a tendency to be afraid of what people are going to think of it. So they never fucking put it out there.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I won't lie. I have some things that I've done that I won't put out there because I'm like, nobody's going to like this shit. I'll just keep it to myself.
See, fresh
as fuck.
But once you put it out there, man, it's the world. It's no longer yours. And that's the life of an artist.
And that's, you know what? And I think that's something else I have a problem with, is the fact that if I put something out, it's no longer mine anymore. Like it's, I have to share it. And I'm just like,
look, it's the fucking curse, man. You got to be judged. That's just the fucking, that's the curse you live with. But you know what? You were given a gift. So fuck it. You got to go out there. And I mean, I'm just saying, we're given gifts. You're given a gift. Steve Bravo, you do fucking ridiculous shit. And of course, and you got to know, like, not everybody's going to love everything. But at the end of the day, you got to watch. That's the thing. Artists, Carlos, you can, you know, Ryan, everybody can kind of understand this. The fucking biggest thing is we have to walk the fucking plank every time we put something out there.
Oh, my God. It's so nerve-wracking.
But that's just it. Like, I'm going to go ahead and chime in for oh, well, fuck it. That frame of mind, right?
Right.
Because you don't know who's looking and you don't know who enjoys your stuff. And you just got to continue to put things out there because, for example, Rookie, we had a conversation on Instagram yesterday, I think it was, and he was talking about how, man, I look forward to looking at all the stuff that you do. And I'm like, man, I'm looking at your Instagram feed, looking at the stuff that you do, because I think your stuff is hilarious. You know, so it's not even, I mean, you can put things out there. You just don't, number one, you don't know who's watching. And number two, it's yours. People can consume it the way that they want. But if you don't like it, like, you know, like Risky just said, like, you, maybe you'll like the next one. But you can borrow ownership for however long you want to look at it. But
it's very natural as us as humans to want to be accepted, right? That's a supernatural thing. And part as artists, it's like you want everyone to like it. The thing is, the biggest thing with an artist is you have to fucking trick yourself into saying fuck it, right?
Right.
You gotta be able to be like, cool. And I always go into that my shit like everyone's gonna hate it, and then so when anybody likes it, it's fucking gravy.
Yeah,
which brings you to fuck it that much faster.
Right.
Like anytime I show something and someone is like, oh, I like that a lot. That's dope. I look at them like, what the fuck is wrong with you? You like this shit? What the fuck?
Steve, I can genuinely tell you, without a doubt, and I'm not saying this as lip service as you being on the show, I can swear to God, hand to God, honestly tell you, there has not been one thing that I've ever seen you put out in public that I've even thought was mediocre. Everything
you've done. Did we tell you that Risky is an atheist?
I am too. So when we die, we just see darkness. It's okay.
I am so not. Anyway, no, but I'm saying like everything I can honestly tell you, anything I've seen you put out, I haven't even thought of as being, I've always thought of being as so fresh, so dope, so original. And even like your ideas that are a collaboration of pop culture things, the way you put them together is so original in that sense that, I mean, everything I've seen you do is fresh that I've seen you put out there. There's not one thing that, and I'll be super honest if I've ever thought anything was like, oh, that's cool. Like everything you've done, I've never even thought as even being on a level of mediocre. I've always thought it's been really, really dope and fresh and added something new to the spectrum of what we have.
Wow. Thank you. I appreciate it. I don't believe you, but I appreciate it.
That's the fucking artist. I swear to God.
Yeah. It's great.
I have one person. There's one person.
And I'm saying all this is so I can buy a piece from you and maybe you give me like a heartbeat of a discount.
I got you. Don't worry about it. I got you.
Trade work because Risky has a badass album that he can pass you.
Let's go.
Yeah.
Let's go. Hey, I'm a big believer in the barter system, man.
I got a blank wall right here. So.
Oh, I see. Yeah, you need to fill that up.
I'm filling it. I got frames, but I got plenty of spaces to put stuff, and I'd love to have a Bravo piece.
Yeah, I got you.
My wall blank.
Man, that piece is so old.
All of a sudden, everybody's... I'm not going to say anything, but if we go ahead and do like this, I'm going to go ahead and point out that's Steven Silver signed. He's the guy who did the Kim Possible concept art.
That's the wrong Steve.
And, you know, some other folks up there, you know, just saying there's space on my wall, too. So, you know.
You know what's weird? I don't have any art on my walls at all. Isn't that weird? Like at home, I don't have any art on the walls. I got pictures of like real life human beings, but like
nothing. Yeah, but I bet you got a lot of music, which is art.
There you go. I'm sorry, it's just not on the walls.
Have you been interested in other people's art, or are you just kind of like, I can?
You know, I've been interested in art since even before music. I just didn't start until late, like really, really late. Even though I did, I went to Illinois Institute of Art.
Chicago or?
Yeah, Chicago.
Brian and I went to the one in Schaumburg.
Ah, shit. You went to the whack one. I'm sorry. No, I'm joking. I got a buddy that went to, went to that one. But I went to, and in high school, I went to Dunbar, which is a vocational school, and my major was commercial art. So I've always been
nice
in art, but I didn't actually start making anything until like a few weeks ago.
That DJ life, boy.
We live in an art camp. We live in an art city too, man. There's so much art, and we have, I think it was voted the number one museum in the world, the Art Institute of Chicago, with some of the greatest pieces of art in the history of art, art's existence, you know, like fine art's existence, right?
Yeah.
Do you have a favorite piece at the Art Institute or a favorite artist?
I have a favorite artist. That's rough. Not a lot of favorite artists. I want to talk about some Chicago artists that I think are dope as fuck. And they're super young too, comparatively. They're sure. Super young. Armani Howard is dope as fuck.
Yeah,
that motherfucker is doing some like just incredible shit. There's a young lady, her name is Kayla May. If you look up on our Instagram, Kayla May Art, I think is her Instagram tag. I mean, what she's doing is just, man, I love it so much. Like it you know, something is good when you see it, and it makes you feel instantly. As soon as you see it, it's like instant, like, oh my God. Like when I see every time she puts up something new, I get like these chills, like, fuck, this is dope.
Yeah.
Like, and not a lot of things affect me like that. But as far as like famous artists, man, that list is crazy. George Condo. I like George Condo a lot. I like old school artists like Gustav Klimt. He's dope as fuck.
Klimt's amazing, yeah.
Who the else?
Embrace, I mean, his big one is The Embrace, right, Klimt?
Yeah. It's too many to name, though. It's like, I'll tell you, my favorite artist of all time is Jack Kirby. That's my favorite artist.
He's a bad man.
I knew he was going to pull out his arm. Jesus Christ.
Bad man.
Yo, listen, Jack Kirby was on. I don't think Jack Kirby was human. There's no way he could be human making the shit that he was making. Like, if you look at like how intricate and complicated, like some of the machines that he was making, it's like there's no human doing shit like that. That's not human work. That's some other shit. That's like, I don't know. I don't know if it's good or bad. It could be demonic. It could be angelic. Who knows? But that shit moves me in a way that I can't even explain.
What was the first year? Like, when did you find Jack Kirby?
I found Jack Kirby, like, I've been buying comic books. Maybe late 70s is when I found Jack Kirby.
Do you remember the first book? Or the first?
No, I don't. I do not remember the first book. I mean, but here's the thing. I didn't know who was who until I got older. And I was like, oh, that was Jack Kirby. Oh, shit. Oh, that was Jack Kirby, too? Mm-hmm. Oh, shit, I remember that. It's like, oh, shit, this motherfucker's been in my life for a long time.
Yeah. Yeah, I feel like that. Like, Jack Kirby is Jack Kirby and Alex Ross for me.
Alex Ross is dope. And Alex Toth.
Yeah.
Toth is ridiculous. Oh, my God.
We got Matt says in our chat room, Alex Toth too. At what point, and this is a question for everybody, but at what point do you think, because I think we're there now, but when do you think people finally started recognizing comic book art as legit art?
Some people have a hard time accepting
that. Okay.
It. I think people that have been comic book enthusiasts and appreciators, I think they've always seen it as, you know, that's what they were drawn to, was the art.
Right.
The art before the story. They saw the pictures before they read the story.
Right.
So all comic book enthusiasts, you know, they're not reading, you know, comic books with no pictures. So, but here we go again. Normal people look at that and say, oh yeah, that's just comic book art. That's not real.
Right.
I'm like, all right, cool. Whatever. Live your life.
Right.
So, but I still don't think we're there yet. I think when it's presented as pop art, quote unquote pop art, or is presented in combination with something else, then people are like, oh, okay, that's acceptable to my normal brain now. Okay, because right. you used it with something else that I equate as art.
Yeah.
But those are the same knuckleheads that'll sit there and see a set of stairs that got painted and beat up with a chain, and they're like, ooh, look at the emotion of it.
Right.
Man, get out of here.
Oh, my God. What? They call that something. What do they call it?
Modern art.
Yeah, I hate modern art. I'm not.
I call it dumb.
It's like, what? How is it modern? I don't understand the rules.
Yeah, I don't either. And just because you made it doesn't mean that we need to sit here and babysit your emotions.
Right. Like,
if you make something and it's just not good.
I call it trust fund art.
Trust fund art. Yeah. You mad because you can't draw? Boy.
I don't know. I might do some modern art. It'll be interesting.
Don't do that. That'll be when Risky finally says, so remember when I said
take all of it back now. Yeah. Where did he go? He just left. You want to refill
his browser crashed.
Yeah, he's having some internet issues.
Yeah. So when was it that you realized that you had the skills to get into art and then started moving in that direction?
I mean, I haven't realized it. Well,
yeah, that's a fair point.
It's still an ongoing realization.
Yeah,
I started with graphic design, which I did professionally, still do professionally, and people liked my design. They liked my work. Like, okay, well, this is art. Maybe I could transition into something else. Mm-hmm. Let me start making stuff that's in my head. Things that I'm not prompted to make. Things that are just like organic to me. Let me make that stuff and see how people react to that. The first time I ever did a show was it was, and this is, and I hate using this reference because it makes me sad, but the first show I did was 2 days before Timbuktu passed away. Mm-hmm. And it was at it was a show that Walter J. Livharder had put together. It was an art show plus like a rap show. And it was the first time that I actually hung art on the walls for people to look at. And it was an eye-opening experience. Had I not done that, I may not be doing this now.
Wow.
Just to see people standing there and like pointing at your work and like talking to each other, like close, like, and you're just like, what the fuck are they talking about? And they're pointing and looking. I'm like, oh shit, this
like it for real.
Somebody, no, not necessarily, but they had, I don't know if they liked it, but I can see they had a reaction to it.
Yeah.
So it was the reaction that made me say, okay, what else can I make to cause a reaction,
yeah,
in people. So that's where it all started.
That's dope. It had to be nerve wracking. That had to be nerve wracking.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh,
luckily you were DJing that show too. So.
Oh, you know what? I didn't get to DJ though. I was supposed to, but I didn't get to. But it's fine. I don't have to DJ everything.
Why didn't you DJ? I remember.
Cause he was busy watching people talk about his work.
I was, and I had a few people there that I was tending to, but it just didn't work out time wise.
Yeah, it was a good show.
But you know, it's no big deal. That's not what I took away from it. Like, fuck, I didn't get to DJ. That shit sucked.
I never would have thought that that was your first show.
Really?
Yeah, I wouldn't have thought that.
See, why wouldn't you think that?
Because everything was hung like it should have been hung. Like, did you hang your own artwork?
Yeah.
Yeah,
everything. Yeah, that was the first time I hung.
Like, between all the other artists that was there, because I know it was a couple other artists there.
And yeah, Deal was there. I could tell you who was there. Deal and Art by Jungle. That's who was there. Art by Jungle is dope. He had these big, gigantic, huge, like, canvases, just, like, crazy shit. Like just sick. Hmm. And Deal, I was like, Deal was on, like, Deal's work resonates with me a lot, too, because it's a lot of shit from my memory. Like, shit that I just love as a child and an adult. I'm like, okay, I fucks with this. This is a good show because I like the other artists that are here, too.
Yeah.
So, but the reason why my shit was hung like that is because I'm a fucking professional, Sean Doe. See, what you don't understand is...
I totally forgot all that shit, bro. Like,
I'm all about precision when it comes. Like, I've been in graphic design. I have to be precise. Yeah. So that should just translate it to, you know, I gotta present this shit like I would present like work.
Exactly, and that's the thing that separates you and other people from the rest is that attention to detail and knowing that even though that may be your first time, you're paying attention, you're seeing that shit, you know how it's supposed to be done.
Yeah, I'm treating it like a design project, like, you know, okay.
Right.
Darrell wants to ask about what Noxic.
Yeah. What about that? What does he want to know?
I mean, he was talking about it. Jesus.
He was there.
I think he might just want, you know, a little plug. See,
what Noxic, here's a lot of people don't know that I rapped for a very long time. I was a rapper. And my second group, third group was What Noxic. It was me and my friend Wiley Styles, who is as a matter of fact, that's probably the person I've talked to the most is Wiley, still to this day. I'll give you some background on him later, but we, you know, kids in the hip hop, we were from two different groups. We met at this at this thing Darrell used to do, Lower Links. I don't know if you're familiar or you remember that. Sean Doe, did you go to Lower Links?
I didn't go to Lower Links. I was outside. I wasn't outside.
Get out of here, man. You couldn't go out there.
I told Darrell that I went. I told him I was outside. I couldn't get in. I wasn't old enough.
But yeah, we were also the first group to sign with Columbia College. Has a record label called Amp Records. We were the first rap group on Columbia College's record label, which is weird. So we put out an album, some other shit, but you know, we got distracted, which is, you want to hear the crazy shit is we both, he did it before me, but we both went into art. Like after that, like he's a, like, designer. This motherfucker's like been the head of creative at like video game companies and shit. He's
nice.
Been
the
creative director at, like, he's done big games like Splinter Cell and shit like that. Like, dude has done some big shit afterwards. Yeah.
So is there any because you guys signed with this, well, no, put out this music with this label, do you think Columbia College has record of that music, or
do you I hope they destroyed all of that shit. That shit was not that great. Like, because at that point, we didn't really know how to, we didn't know how to record. We didn't know what the fuck we were doing. Mm-hmm. And like, we were just going on instinct. Because nobody set us down and said, no, stupid, you don't do it like this. You do it like this. Nobody has set us down at this point. I didn't get training until later from Andy C, which That's a whole other fucking story. That's like some Jedi level training shit.
I was gonna say you can't. There's not many people better than to get trained by than Andy C.
Oh my god, dude, he changed my life. Like music wise, like I mean, I don't make music anymore. I play around just for myself, but he trained me so well that I could just do it instantly. Like I can just do it. I can just pop in the studio and just make some shit, some acceptable shit, just based on the training that he got me. I mean, he gave me certain rules and like just, he gave me a guide and that shit. You know what? And now that I'm thinking about it, I've been really lucky because I've been in contact with a lot of fucking masters of shit. Like, I think that's helped me a lot too. I've between Howie, DeRoe, 33 and a Third, Twilight Tone, fucking Andy C, whoever, even Doug Infinite, he might not even realize. I had two conversations with Doug Infinite in the 90s that basically shaped how I make music also, which is really weird. Like I've been lucky enough to have contact with masters, and that's helped me a lot. That's what you need. You need mentors. If you want to do some shit, people do not understand the importance of having a mentor or just somebody you can talk to that has done it and has seen it and it understands it. That shit helps out. That shit levels up your game like crazy, like you wouldn't even believe.
Not to mention, they fought the fight. And so they've jumped hurdles that you don't need to jump because they've already jumped them. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Or even if you do, go ahead.
They've had the fight that you are about to have. So they know the cheat codes. That's what it is. They have the cheat codes. You know, some will give it to you and some won't. But the thing about the ones that won't give it to you, like just blatantly give it to you, all you have to do is sit back and watch.
That too.
Which would be my relationship with Twilight Tone. I don't think me and Twilight Tone, in the 4 years that we DJed and as long as we've known each other, I don't think we've had a conversation. But with me watching him and just like and studying, it was like going to fucking school, man. It was like going to DJ school. Mm-hmm. It was crazy.
Yeah, that's what I did. I did that with Twilight too. Like I talked to Twilight like many years later. I used to go to a lot of the parties when I would come home from school. So you might know Craig Elliott.
Yeah, me and Craig got the same birthday. Yeah,
that's crazy. Craig, I went to Alabama A&M with Craig, and when I would come home, I would go to all the parties that he went to. And, you know, he was hanging tough with Twilight, and I just recently told Twilight maybe a couple of years back, I was like, yeah, I used to, like, I paid my dues. I used to carry your records. You know what I'm saying? Because that's what Craig was doing. And when I would go to the shows, I would just watch Twilight. Like, just watch. So he's trained probably a lot of people.
Oh, absolutely.
Without even knowing. Absolutely. Like, I had to give him his props, too, because, you know, he deserves it. Like he did a lot for us.
Twilight Tone is the father of a lot of DJs out there. Like a lot, like I can hear a DJ. It's weird. I can listen to a DJ and I can know who he's listened to. And Twilight Tone has a lot of DJ sons and daughters out here.
Yeah, I agree.
Back to Wocnotics for a quick second. DeRoe said he's got an unopened cassette.
Out of
what?
Oh, yeah.
What?
Tell him to destroy that.
Oh.
I don't even have one.
Not before we get that for the archive.
Oh, yeah.
That's history.
Do you have the work song I did with Gravity? I mean, Gravity did?
No.
I know
that's what you're gonna send it.
That's a hot song.
Right.
Now that's a hot song.
Shout out to Grav.
That's after Andy C training. As a matter of fact, you should listen to Wocnotics And then listen to that song and you will see, like, okay, somebody trained him.
That's dope. That's
dope. Oh, I did some shit for Quelo too.
Did you? What off what album?
I don't know the name of the album, but I did Coco and I did
that's on that. I know what I just can't think of the name.
What else? It was on a B side of Coco. Actually, I did about eight. Well, they got eight tracks from me. I've only heard two, the Coco and the B side to Coco. I don't know what they did with the rest of it.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, I've been out here. I dabble. I dabble.
So, what other DJs have you? Because, like, I think about the DJs that influenced me in Chicago, and like, I know Tone is one. DJ SP1 put me on the tables, so that's the reason. That's probably partially one of the reasons why I DJ.
I can tell you. Okay, I went to high school with Mustafa, which is weird.
Did you?
Yeah. The DJs who influenced you. All right, so the first DJ that influenced me, like that I actually talked to about DJing was Lori. She was the Rose DJ in his group. He Walks Three Ways. She put me on to some things. Spin, DJ EV Spin. Yeah. He put me on some shit. DJ Heather, who I thought was like the dopest DJ I had ever heard and shit, which used to spin that Red Dog. Diz. Who else? Diz is
cool.
I heard Diz by accident. I went to this I don't know where I was coming from, but I ended up at this club on, I want to say it was on Chicago. And at the time, it was, all right, you remember where the Liquid Kitty was in Chicago? This was across the street from that, but this was in early 90s. And this was the first time I heard Diz DJ. And I was just like, what the fuck is this shit? This shit is crazy. Like, it was just like, that shit moved me and shit. Later on, I became friends with Diz. It was just really strange because I'm just like, man, I remember just hearing you by accident and shit. And I think two weeks later, which is weird, I think I tried to go back to that club and it had turned into a cowboy like club and shit. Like it turned into a Western club.
Diz wasn't there no more, huh?
Nah, Diz wasn't there. unless he changed his look up dramatically, he wasn't there.
Diz, big ups to Diz. Like he's definitely like, I don't know if he gets the props that he deserves, but he's such a dope DJ, and he's a really good person too. Like,
yeah,
like he's absolutely a really good person. So,
and also Diz is a dope producer. But here's the thing about what you don't realize about Diz: he plays house. But have you ever heard Diz play hip hop? Yo, that motherfucker is insane with hip hop.
Yeah.
And I tell you, somebody else I've heard play hip hop. I've heard Derek Carter play hip hop.
You know what? I wish I'd never heard him play hip hop, but I know he raw. Just by looking like his persona, like how he is, I know he, like, that's probably eyes closed, Derek Carter.
When you hit house DJs on that level and they play hip hop, it stops you in your tracks because you're like, what's happening? What's going on? What the fuck is this? Then you look and you're like, oh, this motherfucker is playing hip hop in the middle of a house set with no interruption, it just flowed right into it. I'm like,
damn,
this is amazing. Yo, Chicago DJs, man, fuck it. Chicago DJs are the best DJs on the planet. Like, it's nothing. I mean, the closest is New York, but it's Chicago all day. Got the best DJs on the planet Earth.
Yeah.
Maybe Philly got some dope DJs because, you know, Jazzy Jeff came out of Philly. And that's the God right there. But it's like, Chicago. I'm sticking with that. I'll fight a motherfucker over that shit too. Yeah. You want to fight? You come see me.
Yeah. Yeah, and it's a lot of us that I think we had that same sentiment. I can tell how you got that too. Like, you were just thinking about how, you know, like, we grow up, we listen to disco, we was listening to house music, and then the transition for us was like, okay, cool, in the hip hop. But yeah, you would think that we would be more open-minded to know that the DJs that are spinning disco, that are spinning house, probably do spin disco. Like, I know how people look at, like, Tone B Nimble. Like, Tone B Nimble, you know, hip-hop was attached to his name through him spinning out and then the label. But if you listen to him and, like, what he really spins, like, he spins a lot of disco and how, and it's just Chicago. Yeah. It's just what we do. You know,
that motherfucker, yo, Tone B Nimble, yo, I don't think anybody, let me think about this before I say it, hold on. I don't think I've known a DJ that loves disco as much as Tone B Nimble. I know people that love disco, but when it comes to DJ, I don't think I've met a DJ who has equal love for hip hop and disco, but loves disco as much as Tone B Nimble.
Yeah, I
can see that.
I can. Well, Larry Miller, but Larry Miller is new DJ. Larry Miller is new to 2000s, and I've heard Larry grow, and Larry's fucking dope as fuck now.
Yeah.
Sean Dervis is another DJ that can play anything.
Yeah,
like anything. Like Sean Dervis is going to a that motherfucker. Play a Calypso record and shit. You know, and that shit'll move.
Mm-hmm.
Fucking Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
that's Chicago shit. Man, so many DJs I'm leaving out, but I mean, it's not because I don't think about them, I don't love them. My memory's just bad.
Yo, so I used to do this thing over at Sonotech. It was, and I'm not gonna name names.
Do it.
So I used to do this thing with Stone's Throw over at Sonotech to do it once a month. And one month they had the Stone's Throw DJs there and Twilight Tone spun. And you know how that booth was in Sonotech, you know, unmatched the rotary mix.
The sound quality was ridiculous.
I watched those DJs, and I'm not gonna name the DJs that was there, but I watched those DJs stand and look at Twilight Tone in awe. Like they were just in amazement. And Twilight Tone.
Okay.
If they'd have saw Tone B Nimble too, that would have been, but
it would have been too much for them.
There would have been a whole bunch of turntables on sale on Craigslist.
Yeah. Well, I just think that there's just something about us as Chicago DJs that the way we go into, like, the things that we play and the transitions that we make, it's just different. We do it different than everybody else. And I watch them, and I know, like, they're known around the world for their names. And they watch Tone, and they look like, it could have been easily, it could have easily turned into jealousy. You know what I mean? It could have easily turned into that. But I just looked at that and said,
listen,
our shit's dope.
It's been times, I won't lie to you, I've gone to parties and I walked out pissed because a motherfucker was that good. But this is in my DJ life. It wasn't hate. It was like, I got to get home and I got to fucking practice.
Yeah.
Because this motherfucker is dope.
Yeah.
And I would just leave. Yo, I'm going to tell you another thing. That shit happens to me with art too. Like, I'll go to a show and I'll see some shit. I'm like, fuck, I got to go. I'm out. I got to leave. And then I go straight home, come to the studio and make some shit.
That's me too. That's why whenever you see me, I'm always walking around with something that I can write with.
Mm-hmm.
I see the wind blowing, I'm like, ooh, there's an idea. Yep. You gotta write that down. How has like, we're probably about the same age, but how has let me set it up like this. Back when we were kids, there was nothing like what's happening today, like social media and everything. How has social media affected your career?
Honestly, I'm not huge. First of all, I'm really, you can ask anybody. If you see me in person, then you better play the lottery that day, because you saw a fucking unicorn, because I don't go to a lot of shit anymore. So I'm kind of the same way on social media. I have spurts when I'm like, I'll just post a bunch of shit and then I won't do anything for a month. So it's not, you know, I don't rely on social media. It helps. I will say this, it helps. I mean, I've got a lot of good response and a lot of great feedback through social media, but I don't want to depend on it because I'm waiting for the blackout. So, because when the blackout comes, it's like, now if you're social media dependent, your career is over.
Mm-hmm.
Like, nobody's here's looking.
I always tell that to my 3D friends that don't want to draw, right? Like, you're a good solar flare away from being irrelevant.
Being irrelevant, yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So
you see me painting on cave walls. Meanwhile, you're over there trying to click a mouse that don't even work anymore.
Exactly. I love technology. I embrace technology wholeheartedly. But I know that is, like you said, one solar flare away, and it's like, you know, pen and paper, like all the fucking drawing pads are sold out at Blick. You can't find the pencils on eBay for $3,000 and shit. It's like, it's going to come to that one day. And everybody on social media that has these careers, like all these Instagram models and all this shit, they're fucked because we can't see you anymore. So you're not relevant.
They're about to change the game on that too. All the like numbers and stuff that you see, all that's going to go away soon.
That's a bad idea.
I agree with you, but they're catering to the kids that don't know how to handle rejection.
Fuck that shit. Fuck them. You need rejection. You can't grow without rejection.
Exactly.
How the fuck do you grow without rejection?
Exactly. If I put trash up there, I don't want you to tell me, hey, that's really good. I need you to tell me that's trash. Pull that shit down.
Yeah. See, that's why I'm not afraid of millennials at all. I'm not afraid of the youth because they're weak. Like, there's no way they could live the way that I've lived at certain points in my life. Like, they couldn't cope. They would break under the pressure. Like, they don't frighten me at all. They're like cartoons to me. In a good way. They're cute cartoons, but they're like, you know, they're cartoons.
Yeah.
And the participation trophies is really fucking up. Now, here's the thing. You know what? I take that back. Let me go back. I don't want to make a general statement like that. Because there are some that are very aware of what things are and how things are. Mm-hmm. I've met a few. I've been lucky enough to meet a few young cats that are like, that have the same same insight as old as me.
Yeah,
which is really strange. So I'm like, wow, at the age that you are, you're half my age, you already understand what I understand. You must have a fucked up life. You must have had a rough ass life.
Right.
So there are some. And those motherfuckers are the motherfuckers that's gonna take over.
Yeah.
Because they're the strongest. But, you know, one thing I do like about millennials though is they are a loving bunch to a certain extent.
Yeah.
They are very collaborative. They are very understanding. They are sensitive to people. Overly sensitive to a point. Mm-hmm. But I mean, you know, the pendulum swings both ways, so it'll come back to that. But you know, it's some that are out here that are doing some good things. So I don't want to just talk bad about them. Like, fuck these young kids, they don't know. But some of them know. Some of them know.
But there's definitely two batches, because there's the ones that are killers that they come out here and they, you know, they figure things out. Like, like for example, go on YouTube and see how many of these kids are out here just killing it, doing exactly what they want to do. And the older generation is upset because they never got to do what they wanted to do.
Exactly. That's why I don't hate on them. I'm like, you luck. I sit back like, you lucky motherfucker.
Right.
To grow up now, you are a lucky bastard. Right.
Yeah.
Because we didn't have all these outlets.
But then you have the other batch that, you know, they don't get as many likes on Instagram, and all of a sudden they need a safe space and a puppy and some hot cocoa. That's right. A true story.
Right.
So yeah, like I agree, especially with folks like you. Like, I always say this on my other show, there has never been a cooler time to be an artist.
Oh my God.
Ever.
That's crazy. You know what? Here's the thing about millennials. Can I call them millennials? Is this something else after millennials? What is it?
There's
millennials generation. What is it? Generation Y or some shit? And then
Generation Y is before millennials.
It is.
Are we at Z?
Yeah, okay. We're Generation X. The next one is Y. Then you have millennials.
So millennials are technically Z.
It's a long time ago.
But there's something after millennials now too.
We should be grandparents now.
Yeah.
Listen, their access to information, I can't imagine, and they were born into this access to information. I can't imagine receiving all the information that we have now when I was their age. I would have lost my mind. I would have been like MODOK or something. I would have just lost my fucking mind.
Yep.
And you know, I don't think I could have handled that much information.
Yep. I agree. That's why we
had to read books to learn shit.
Right.
You had to go to the library card catalog, and if someone took your book, that's it. You just didn't learn that day.
Right. Dude, you fucked up. You had to find out when that book was coming back and just sit there all day waiting for that fucking book.
Yeah. Yeah. And if you got that one dumbass that just kept the book overtime, you're like, man, I gotta
report him. He's fucking up the whole system and shit.
Man, I remember being I went to school at Triton. I got my first degree at Triton College. And I remember when they first started getting the internet there, I walked up to the computer and I clicked on a couple of just horrible websites. I was like, man, this is not going to catch on.
the Angel Fire websites and Alta Vista websites.
Right? Yeah.
Rocket Mail, yeah, all this shit.
Oh yeah,
I forget that. I went to, you know, when I first got on the internet, I went to West Virginia State College, and I got a job in a computer lab, and that's how I was introduced to the internet. And it was interesting back then, man, because it's like it wasn't a lot of shit to look at.
Right.
Shit used to load at like, I mean, the slowest speed. You might as well just fax a picture. That's how slow shit would just come up. And then, you know what? I had a thought today. I was thinking, for some reason, I had this random thought, like, how the fuck did we get pictures on the internet back then? I don't remember being able to put a picture on the internet.
I remember drawing a picture on a piece of paper, and my scanner was probably just a little bit bigger than the iPhone, and you'd have to drag it. You go from the top of the paper and you drag it down, and then it took that, and then you picked it back up and went to the next section and dragged it down. You couldn't even scan an entire piece of paper without, like, and if you weren't careful, it didn't line up right.
Right, you're screwed.
Yeah.
Wow.
No, just like a Picasso.
Yeah. And that box of horseshit scanner that I had, that was expensive. I was like, get this handheld scanner or eat for a week.
Shit used to be like millions of dollars back then.
Right?
Yeah.
And everything came in like 4,500 floppy disks.
Oh my, yep. Don't even talk about floppy disks.
Photoshop.
Oh my God.
Photoshop, they gave you a big box and it wasn't any kind of marketing. It was all the floppy disks that you needed to install. And they didn't even have Drop Shadow.
Oh, no. Steve.
What's up?
What are you doing now?
I'm on Midwest Radio.
No, I'm talking about what are you doing? Like, what are you doing now? Like art and stuff like that, or music?
Though, you know, I do so many different things.
Yeah, I do know.
So it's like, what am I doing today? Or what am I doing tomorrow? Like, and all that shit don't necessarily fit together either. It's like really random shit. But I am still learning art every day.
Yeah.
Teaching myself art. I'm still a graphic designer by profession. I don't DJ anymore. I do really random DJ gigs, like, I don't know. I can't even, what was the last time I DJed? I don't even remember.
At your art event, I think?
Yeah, at Virgin. But that was so random. I just decided that day, you know what, I want to DJ, so I'm going to do it. But other than that, everything I'm doing is like 90% visual right now. Nice. I'm working on some secret music shit right now. I don't even want to get into it, but I'll talk about it at this point because I don't want to jinx it.
Yeah.
But I am getting, you know what? And I don't even want to say music. Let's just say a sound. Mm. So that's my next thing. And animation. I need to learn animation, man. I know a little bit, but not enough to make something that makes sense.
Reach out.
Well, I got you.
I got you. I was just actually right before you got on, I was showing Sean some of the stuff that I was working on. Yeah. Or you can go to youtube.com/coconutjust.
I know.
Subscribe.
Yeah. I'll do that. I'm going to do that. Man, yeah. I got so many YouTube subscriptions. I'll help you as much as I can. What are you using?
I use a bunch of different things. I'll do some stuff. It depends on what it is, but I'll do some stuff in After Effects.
Okay.
Sketchbook is free now, and they have a dope ass frame by frame animation stuff.
Really?
Yeah. It's legit. And then I do most of it in Adobe Animate.
Okay. All right. Yeah. I need to learn After Effects. I haven't.
Oh, I got After Effects. And then Matt says TV Studio Paint, which costs Toon Boom, which costs. both of those are very legit too. Oh yeah, and like you said, you can animate in Photoshop too. Yeah.
Oh yeah. You know what I use? Like the animations, I use a Cinema 4D. So. Oh, I've done some animations in Cinema 4D.
And Blender.
Blender's so dope. Yeah. And I don't know how to use it. I watch tutorials and I'm like, I'll never be able to do that. I'm so deep into Cinema 4D. Like I've invested years into Cinema 4D. And I'm like, I look at the stuff that they're doing in Blender and I'm just like, this shit is incredible. With the update to 2.8, new 2.8 version with the rendering in there looks insane.
Oh, and they got this thing called what is it? Not paper pencil, but wax pencil, something like that.
Oh, yeah.
Where you can draw on top of the you can actually take a 2D thing and do 2D animation in a 3D environment.
Yeah.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
We're in the fucking future, man.
Injection. I'm telling you. Like, I sit here and I can't, as a kid, I always wanted to work on cartoons.
Mm-hmm.
And I accidentally, like, I'm legit working on cartoons.
Right.
I woke up one day and I'm working on cartoons. I was like, whoa, I'm here.
That's dope.
Wow.
That's crazy. I woke, you know what? I had a similar experience. Like, I worked in the toy industry. And I worked at a company called Tomy, the Japanese toy company. So the first thing I worked on was Thomas the Train. But the second thing I worked on was Pokemon. And I'm just like, how crazy is this that they trust me to work on this shit? Like, I'm like, what is wrong with them? They've lost their fucking minds. They let me work on Pokemon. Holy shit. Okay, fuck it. Then, I mean, I went up and I was like, oh shit, they let me work on Disney shit? Oh fuck, these motherfuckers. Yeah. They just fucking just throwing shit out willy-nilly. Yeah.
That's me too. People are like,
everything I get, I'm just like, I can't believe you can't let me do this shit.
People are like, oh yeah, I want to work at Disney. I want to work at DreamWorks. And I'm like, yeah, that'd be dope. And then I go and I read my resume. I was like, oh wait, I did.
Yeah, that's dope. You learn something new about your friends every day. I did not know you worked on Pokemon and stuff.
Yeah.
You didn't know that?
That's awesome.
That's dope. Yeah. It's crazy how many It's crazy how many people that we know that's worked on stuff like stuff that we've seen every day. Like, I think a Slang worked on Animaniacs.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yep.
Come on.
Oh, shit. I didn't know that.
Yep.
That's dope. Good stuff.
That's another art influence of mine, Slang. I remember when Slang was doing, when he had the airbrush shop on
95th. Yep.
He was doing dope shit over there. But even before that, I knew Slang.
Yeah, I would go up to 95th and just watch him. Like, my biggest influences as far as, like, when I started doing graffiti was Spin from Basif and and Slang.
Yeah.
And they both had airbrush shops, so you can just go and hang out. Spin had the airbrush shop in Evergreen Plaza downstairs. Mm. And
I remember that.
Mm-hmm.
I remember that.
The right side of the mall on the bottom floor. Uh-huh. And yeah, he was dope. And actually, he was the one when I used to go and watch him every day, and then I was just thinking about doing graffiti. So I was like, man, I want to do graffiti. And he was like, man, you should. So I went back and I was like, I think I want to name my crew CBS. And he was like, yeah, there's been some factions of CBS, but you know, in 92, 91, you know, there was no CBS. So he was like, you should do it. And that's kind of how, like, and then years later, like recently, maybe about a year ago, he told me something that blew my mind away. He said, I've been looking for you for years. He was like, the way I drew my S's back then made him change the way he drew his S's. So somebody who I looked up to, who was like a graffiti god to me,
right?
He changed the way he wrote his first letter. Like, because I wrote Sean One, he wrote Spin. He changed the way he wrote his S because of me. Wow. And I was like, that's crazy. Like,
listen,
crazy.
I completely just forgot about my whole graffiti life. <That's crazy.
laughs>
Yo,
I have to talk about that.
I'm a rarity in Chicago because I have literally lived in every neighborhood in Chicago, from uptown to Roseland. I've lived everywhere from South Shore to to Maywood. So it's like I got a chance to, in grade school, I went to school in Uptown, the school called Arai, Joan F. Arai. And that's where I learned, that's where I learned about hip hop. And also that's where I learned about graffiti. So it was a lot of legendary Chicago graffiti artists that I went to school with that I didn't even realize were that big until later on in life. Then I went to Dunbar on the South Side, and that's where, for some reason, it seemed like all the South Side graffiti artists went to the same school. It was crazy. So I'm getting the North and South Side graffiti artists. Like, I'm getting it from both of them. It was just crazy. Like, I would hang out at Sin and Sullivan. So on the South Side, the crew was IAC, and on the North Side, what was the crew? I want to say it was UAC. It was weird, but I forgot what crew, like the Twins, Jerk and Dose. I forgot what crew they were in. It was just crazy. So I absorbed a lot of graffiti shit, like when I was in school, like so much so that my handwriting is graffiti. Like that's how I write shit. And I can't stop. Like it's I try to write like regular letters that people can read, but I can't. It just comes out graffiti. It just comes out as tagged and crazy. Ghetto culture. So
did you belong to any crews when you were younger?
Nah. That's the thing. I've been associated, like I know a lot of crews, but I would never get in a crew. The same thing with Chicago. If you're in Chicago, you're having some contact with gangs. Mm-hmm. So I knew all the gangs. Like I knew Vice Lords, I knew Disciples, I knew Latin Kings. Like I wouldn't commit to anything. I wouldn't commit to anything. And nobody would bother me, which is weird. I've been really lucky in that regard. I've never had that kind of trouble because I was so cool with everybody.
It was like this.
So it was like that with graffiti. It was like that with gangs. It was like that with DJ shit. It's been like that. Like I've never been part of a crew.
Was it like that when you got into a Twitter fight with Questlove?
Oh shit! That was Jerome. You know what?
Yeah. Listen,
this is what happened with Questlove. Me and Questlove. This is like when I first got on Twitter. Like it wasn't even really a lot of people on Twitter, which is the reason why he even responded to me because it wasn't a lot of people there yet.
Right.
So he had DJed a party in Chicago, and the next day he went on Twitter. He had DJed a party at the Buddha Lounge, and he had got on Twitter the next day and said something to the effect that, "Oh, I don't know what's wrong with Chicago people. I guess they don't like dancing to good music." And I responded back to him like, "No, it's not that we don't respond to good music. We respond to good DJs. So if it was something with you that they were responding to." And then he called me an asshole. And then, like literally he just said, "Oh, you're an asshole." And then he blocked me.
And then he blocked you. God, that must have been one of the first Twitter blocks in history.
But it's weird how he would diss a whole city,
right?
Exactly. And you responded as you should have,
right?
Exactly.
He calls you. He's being the asshole. He calls you an asshole. Right. Blocks you. Which right. I mean, I got a lot of respect for Questlove, but
me too. I love Questlove.
That situation is zero.
I love Questlove.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was because it wasn't. I'm not gonna lie, I was about to say, you know, I wasn't even trying to come at him like that, but I was being I was being shady. I was trying to come at him like, you know, you must have sucked, but I was trying to say it in a nice way.
Mm-hmm.
And he read right through that shit and called me an asshole. So he was right. He was
right. Well, that's what happens when you diss a whole fucking city. Somebody.
Oh, you know. Yeah. No,
especially Chicago, right?
Well,
we have a chip on our shoulder.
And he dissed the DJs that was here. I'm glad you responded to him. Because Chicago, I mean, he knows Chicago is our city is a city that don't let no type of music die. Like, you'll listen to our radio and you will hear James Brown and Mary J. Blige and Migos.
Crucial Conflict and
you know what I'm saying? So we don't let any music die. So we know what good, you know, we know what good music is. It was just probably
Here's the thing. Now thinking about it, it's like, here's the thing that was with, I guess you can call him a celebrity DJ. Here's the thing with celebrity DJs is people don't dance. They just stand around looking at the DJ.
Right.
So he could have been a victim of his own celebrity. That could have been the case. I wasn't there. I couldn't hear his set. But I've heard him DJ. I know he's not whack. Yeah. But just to make a statement like that, I was like, nah, son, you can't just say shit like that and be, you know, think everything's smooth and shit. But, you know, whatever. That's Questlove. I'm Steve Bravo. It's like, what?
You guys are hilarious. Jesus Christ. I hate that Risky bailed out on us.
I know. What the hell? He was like, fuck Steve Bravo. I'm out.
The good news is, or the bad news is, he's not on the show and he's definitely a wonderful personality. The good news is we get to have a fucking conversation.
Oh, wow. Oh, it's not like this normally?
We usually have to listen to Risky for an hour and a half. I'm giving him a hard time because I know he can't respond right now and he's probably listening and I'm loving this. I love that dude though. Risky is our hip hop encyclopedia. He will tell you. He'll tell you when something happened, where it happened, who was there. He'll show you a ticket stub.
And how it's his all time
favorite associated to one said event.
His house the best thing ever.
He's a historian.
Yeah, he is.
Okay.
Yeah. Cool. He's good at it too. So big up TJ Risky Business. Good old Chad Sorensen. Oh yeah, and he has an album out too. What is it called?
She Killed an Ecstasy.
She Killed an Ecstasy.
Look at that. He's not even here and we're plugging for him.
Still plugging. She Killed an Ecstasy. Look at that.
Dope.
Yeah.
I'll check that out. That's another thing, because I'm not really like social media heavy, I rely on people to tell me about things to check out.
So what are you listening to right now?
What am I listening to?
Right there.
Well, I'm weird with music, man. I'm
there it is.
I'm all over the place with music.
This is Risky's album.
That's Risky's album.
And it's called The Fatal.
Do you remember the guy who did the? You remember the artwork on Cage's album?
Let me see.
What's the name of that album, Ryan?
Movies for the Blind.
Movies for the Blind. Yeah. You gotta remember that.
I can't. You said Cage, and I remember an album cover. I can't remember the details of it.
Well, it's the same artist who did that album is the same artist who did his album cover.
Okay, cool.
Yeah, pretty dope. It's a pretty dope album.
He killed it, yeah.
I can tell you what I don't listen to.
What don't you listen to?
I do not listen to new R&B music. Because new R&B is the worst shit that has ever been made.
So would you put...
New R&B is so... It's so, there's no soul. It's so lifeless. It's just not... it's there's no content. There's no, they're literally, they're given a list of words and it's like, put a song together with these words. Oh, like new R&B is terrible.
Especially and, growing up in with the music that we did.
Exactly. Like when people was, and it's not even rap. Like there's some new rap with young rappers that I'm like, okay, he gets it.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, this is dope. But when it comes to R&B, it's just like, this is the same song over and over again.
So what have you, what groups, like name a group that you would be like, it's not like, it's,
I don't know names.
I don't. Yeah. Like, I was going to say,
you mean R&B wise? I don't know names.
Okay.
I don't know any other names at all.
So you haven't listened to her?
Oh, that's different though. Yeah. I have her. I listen to her. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so R&B.
But that's you're talking about like you're talking one in a million, Aaliyah shit. You know what I'm saying? That's like stands out. It's so good comparatively that can you really even call it R&B?
I can call it R&B because I can't call it anything else.
Would you call Anderson .Paak R&B?
Yeah. Yeah,
I would call it soul music.
Okay, so R&B and soul are I obviously like watching podcasts, but my favorite podcast after this one is the Joe Budden podcast. And they
so fuck Sketch Zone then. Okay.
All right.
I was waiting for you to set that table. I was
so they had this that question. Like, what is, what is R&B? Like, what is R&B? Like, because I would say soul music and R&B is pretty much the same thing.
It's not the same. And let me tell you why it's not the same. This is the difference. R&B is somebody singing. Soul music is somebody singing and creating an emotion and setting a tone. R&B doesn't necessarily do that. So it's like, no, how can I say this? Some R&B is soul music, but you know what I'm saying? Like some R&B is soul music. But some, they're one in the same.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know. I'm not explaining it well.
I see what you're saying.
It makes sense, but it's
some R&B that is soul transcends R&B, so you can't call it R&B. You have to call it soul.
Pretty much,
yeah.
That's pretty much what it is. Yeah, it is deeper than R&B. It's like it's called soul for a reason because it touches your soul.
Mm-hmm.
R&B, regular R&B,
like panties.
It's just somebody singing, you know.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
so and now, with that, I like to announce that I'm working on an R&B album. Well, I'm about to change the game.
That's right. That's using them Andy C skills.
I was about to say that's the king of R&B, but that's a bad thing to be called these days, right?
Yeah.
That's not okay anymore.
I wanted to catch up with Andy when I went to Cali, but
yeah. I caught a glimpse of him at the. Did you watch the Sunday service thing, the Coachella?
Oh, he was there.
Yeah, I saw him walk past the camera.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Speaking.
That's Kanye's sound guy now.
Oh, that's dope. He got the right sound guy.
Oh, absolutely.
Who, Andy is?
Yep.
Speaking of Kanye and Sunday service, I got a chance to see Ice Gree. So big up,
Ice
Gree. We had a nice long talk, and it was definitely in the energy of Greg, because Greg was telling stories, and he's talking to me and talking to somebody else, and he's like, yeah, you know, because I'm old school, and because, you know, I'm old school, and I'm like, Gree, your name is Old School Ice Gree, like, we know this. But we had a lot of fun, and I end up linking him with a really good friend of mine. His name is Savannah Joe. And it's crazy because I told Gree, I'm like, yo, you should know this guy. Like, you guys should, you know each other. And Gree told so many stories that he figured out that he knew him from, like, working, like at Loud from back in the day. So, I mean, it was pretty dope. So I'm pretty sure they'll stay in touch and work more now. But yeah, they used to work Loud Records together. So
I used to work Loud Records.
Did you?
I used to work Loud, Sony, and somebody else. So when Wu-Tang came out, actually, no, I didn't start working at Loud until right before Cuban Links came out.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So I think the first record was that I was pushing out was with my friend Audrey was it was a Fat Joe record, and I think it was Ghostface, Raekwon and Ghostface was on the record. It was I can't remember the name of that fucking record, but the one I was the most excited about was the fucking Mobb Deep album with Shook Ones on it. Mm. Was I worked that. I got a chance to work that album. Holy shit. You talk about a shift in Chicago, like the mood and just like shifting rap in Chicago. Yo, I don't think people realize how much Mobb Deep changed Chicago music.
Yep.
Like, it was crazy. When that album came out, you could just hear it like, oh, fuck. All right, you want to get dark? Let's get dark. We're about to go dark now. Oh, shit. Yeah, that record changed Chicago.
Yeah, it did a lot. You just, like,
you had to be there to see it.
Did you have any correspondence with the Cats, the New York office, too?
Yeah, that's who we're going through, the New York office.
So you might know Joe too.
I might. Like I said, man, I know I got too much shit in my head. I don't remember a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
So unless if we haven't had an argument, I'm not gonna remember you.
Let me go log into Twitter real quick.
I remember arguments.
Yeah, it's crazy. So you just put out a shirt, Steve. It's pretty dope.
Yeah, people like it. It's weird. I don't think people would like. I put it out, shit. I'm like, nobody would like this shit. And people like, hey, how do I get this? I'm like, oh, here you go. There's a link. You can get it from here.
So what was? I mean, like, how did you come up with the concept? Did you just add two things that you really like?
First, what's the shirt?
What'd you say?
What's the shirt?
I can't even show it on here, can I? Let me see. Can you see my phone? Let me see.
I can share my screen if you give me a link.
Go to it's on Instagram. Steve_Bravo. And I think it's the latest post up there.
The shirt is
you can see it.
Oh, I saw this one.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Actually, the post before that, there's a better graphic to it. Oh, better graphic for it.
All right.
Yeah, so people like that. So, I mean, I'm pretty random in my thinking. So I make a lot of random shit. Like I got just hundreds of just random shit on my, like maybe thousands of just random ass shit I've made. But this one, I was thinking yeah. I was watching something that, I was watching somebody make Japanese fried chicken. And I was just like, oh shit. And I was like, what if there's a Harold's in Japan? And I started looking, I was like, there's no Harold's in Japan. Fuck, I want to open a Harold's in Japan.
And that's what you did.
And then that's where that came from and shit. It's just like, random shit.
We need to be better friends.
Yeah. That shirt is amazing. When I saw that, I was like, this motherfucker had done it again.
Then I had to talk to my Japanese friends, like, just to make sure that the Japanese characters were right, because sure. I don't want to say some wild shit. Oh, like by DJ Shondo, see? Yeah.
Look at that. Oh, boom. There's another one for you.
Yeah, no, it was amazing. I think you should also do prints, but I think you should do prints on like that paper that they use for the bags for Harold's.
Oh shit, that's a good idea. Or even, you know what? I wasn't gonna do prints. I was, you know,
even stickers. This would be a bad sticker.
I totally would do like maybe 10. Do it on the paper, crumble it up like it's used.
Oh, shit. Put some grease stains in this shit. And put it in a frame. Boom.
Each one, Steve, has 8 chicken on and shit. Like, like you shit. Have limited, like
not even personally autographed by. It's like personally greased up. Yeah. With hot sauce. And
yo, I'm telling you, man, people would go for that shit. Like,
yo, but seriously, I do want to. I was looking at a franchise shit. I actually want to open the Harold's in Japan. So if there's anybody I can help out with that, definitely get in touch with me. I'm dead serious about that. Like,
it's a Garrett's popcorn in Thailand.
What? Yeah. Really?
Yeah, I was.
Which
when
is crazy. When I some random shit?
It was in the airport.
Wow.
It's either in Japan. I think it's in Thailand. It's either in Japan or Thailand. But I know when we stopped off, like at an airport, I'm like, I just rode the plane 25 hours and now I'm right in front of a Garrett's. Like,
but the thing is, especially if you live at home, you get used to it being that good. And when I tell people are like, oh, you know, popcorn. I was like, I got some popcorn for you. Mm-hmm. And they think that I'm playing. And then when I get Garrett's shipped out here and I get cussed out. They tell me, stop ordering this shit because I can't stop eating it. I get cussed out every time I get one of those cans. Every time.
Wow.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, we get spoiled.
Yeah, this is a lot of Chicago shit that, like, I don't know, but definitely I want the Harold's in Japan. Like, I want everything. I want the bulletproof glass. I want bad service, all of that shit. Like, the full experience.
You gotta go and get some Harold's folks and like relocate them out there. Be like, here you go.
Yeah.
Cuss out some Japanese folks real quick.
I want you to be able to call and make an order, and when you get there, your order's not ready. Everything.
You ask for mouth sauce on the side, they put your mouth sauce on the shit. Like,
on the shit.
Let's get the full experience. But yeah, you know what? You gotta pick the Harold's that you like. What Harold's would you want to model your, like, which one?
Oh, like 87. 87 all day.
71st. Oh, 187. Because you get different service at different one. Don't say the one in which you're even if it takes too long.
This message in the chat room from Harold's They said, stop playing. Our chicken is good. Apparently they're in the chat room.
Nobody kidding. Said it was good. Oh, I'm like, yo, that's what I want to share it with the world internationally.
Right.
Can you imagine the heroes in France? Come on, man. That's crazy.
That'd be dope. That'd be in.
Yeah, mild sauce is a mystery to everybody else but us.
I know. They're like, mild sauce?
Yeah, I mean, mild sauce is a mystery to everybody but us. I know I had friends in Detroit like mild sauce. I'm like, you niggas don't have mild sauce down there? Like,
you know who has mild sauce? Baltimore and DC. They have mild sauce.
I believe it.
Yeah.
I believe it because it's like Baltimore. Baltimore is, I've been there because my brother lives in that area, mm-hmm. in like that DC area, stuff like that. And yeah, it's pretty. It looks like it could have mild sauce.
Yeah. Everywhere else, you only get ketchup and.
I think you don't have the
cocktail sauce.
Yeah. Yeah.
So good.
Wow, man. So yeah, once again, if there's anybody listening that can help me open the heroes and or just put me in a, you know, put me on the right path to that. Heroes right. in Japan. I'm very open to talk about that.
Somebody's super serious about it. So yeah. we haven't had your Midway interview, but this is the preamble to that. So
wait, I gotta do another thing?
Yes.
Of course.
Just saying,
hey, yes. This isn't the film.
Oh shit.
He's like, you guys are making a shitty film. You guys are doing it on YouTube? What the
See, here's the thing. I'm like, okay, I know they got the Midway Doc where they got, you know, like the heavy hitters, Chicago heavy hitters. And they got me on the Midway Radio because that's like it's like you were there. It's like the you were there, but you're not quite heavy hitter, heavyweight.
Nah, you a heavyweight. Yeah.
We have the heavy hitters on here too.
Yeah,
look at him. He's fishing for compliments. Don't fall for that.
I saw, you know, you did gravity, right?
Yeah.
Okay, I saw that one. I saw a bunch of them, and I'm like, okay. That's legit. And I'm like, what the fuck would I talk about? You know, like
everything that you just did.
My shit is so random.
First off, I want to tell, like, Carlos could be right. You could be fishing for compliments. But no. What I know you, Steve.
I don't. I fish for silence.
He's like, I'm fishing for a Harold's in Tokyo. Didn't I tell you that?
That's right. You just need to do. You know, we have specific questions that we ask, and okay. You definitely can answer.
You're saving the good questions. Okay.
Yeah. This is just for us to floss that we know you.
Man, that's sad. Listen, if I'm your floss, you get you in trouble.
All right. Let's
Oh shit. This Wait, what's happening now?
Steve Bravo, this or that. What's more nerve-wracking? Your first art show or your first DJ set?
First DJ set. Hands down. Go. First DJ set.
What can you explain?
Because when you have an art show, you hang your shit, you don't even have to be there. Like okay. You just walk away like nobody knows you. You walk away, it's like you don't have it's like you walking away from a crime. You don't have anything to do with it. You're just like, I'm out. DJ set is like, you are there. People are giving you the ice grill and shit. It's like, it's a lot. It's interactive, it's hands-on, and it's like, it's almost like a fight. It's like you're fighting the crowd sometimes. So yeah, definitely DJ set.
Not to mention, like, going back to kind of what you were talking about, your first art show, you were there, people were talking under their breath, and whereas a DJ set, they might throw a drink at you. They might.
The worst is the look. This is the DJ. This is the look I've seen that bothers me the most. They'll do this. And I'm just like, what?
You know, so the worst, the person that DJ that I looked up to, that I seen him get like that look at him, was Mr. Sinister.
Was who?
Mr. Sinister.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, I looked up to him, you know, DJing, you know, doing the DJing for the Common albums, and you know, watching the DMCs back in the day, and then I get this chance to spin with him, and the crowd was not feeling him. Wow. Like, not feeling him, to the point where I think somebody, I know exactly who it was, but he was like, get that motherfucker off the turntable. I was like, calm down. He's like, I don't give a fuck. We're from the north side. North Pole in this bitch. And I was just like,
I've never gotten that. Like, nobody's ever gotten violent. Like, people get a little pushy. Like, if they ask for, can you play something? I'm like, you know what? I'll try. if you don't play it, then it's like, oh, you didn't play the fucking song that I just listened to in the car on my way here. So fuck
you. Right.
All right. I'm sorry. Shit don't work out all the time.
All right, Steve. This or that.
That was it.
Oh, no, shit, you got more? This or that. This or that. It's super easy. Oil or acrylic.
Oh shit, yo! I recently started fucking around with oil, and it's like that shit is like fucking alchemy. Like it's so many ways. Actually, with oil and acrylic, it's so many ways to approach both. But with oil, because of its history and like how people use it differently, and like there's so many things you can do with it, it's really versatile. It's like learning chemistry, but I like it because I like the results of it. Like, there's way much more depth in it. Like, it's the difference between R&B and soul music. Mm. Like, oil is soul music, acrylic is R&B.
And just you wait, because Adobe's coming out with this iPad app that is like, it's blowing people's mind. They have oil, acrylic, watercolor, la la la.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
They've been talking about this shit for a while.
Yeah. It's supposed to be coming out here any minute now.
So Adobe bought the company that makes Substance Painter, right?
Yeah.
What okay, so I remember when they bought Mixamo, and then they put out Fuse, which they didn't really do anything with. They kind of just left it out there like an orphan and shit. Also with Mixamo, they didn't do anything with. This is nerd shit for everybody that's listening. This is art nerd shit. What I'm a little worried about them buying Substance Painter based on what they did with Mixamo. So what you got any insight on that? Like what are they going to do with that shit?
They've been making a heavy push on 3D.
Yeah.
And so they're just scooping up proven technologies right now. I think you're going to see them probably buy up some more 3D stuff. Cause like even now, I don't know if I'm supposed to say this. They don't watch this show. like in anime, you can do VR in anime now.
Right.
So there's that. And then you can do 3D stuff in Photoshop and Illustrator. And right. They also have that one app called, what's it called?
Dimensions.
Right. Yeah. Right. So you're going to see them doing that stuff. They'll be incorporating it, whether or not they're, I haven't heard anything about them like scooping up like like 3D Studio Max or anything like that.
Okay.
But actually, like if you look at it, they might be working on with that stuff. They might work on with not just Photoshop, but also After Effects, because it does play with Cinema 4D. So
Cinema 4D, right. Exactly. Right?
So you might as well, if they're deep with Cinema 4D, so it might be, you know, and that's just speculation, but
right.
But they might be eyeing something like that. Because
I'm still surprised they've never put out a legit 3D modeling software yet. Or bought,
you know that this is Adobe Dimensions. This is their second go at 3D.
Yeah.
Because back when we were in school, I think it was called Adobe Dimensions, but it was hot trash.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But it'll be interesting to see. They might be doing something like that, like looking at either buying up or creating something like a Cinema 4D that okay. that will help, you know, motion designers and stuff. But yeah, they're going deep with this stuff. It's
anybody interested in art, like right now what's happening is it's about, especially 3D, everybody's going to be able to do 3D in a little while. Mm-hmm. Like everybody. And that's going to be really interesting, because when everybody has access to something, like you see who's really talented.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll see like, you will see some, you're gonna see a lot of crap, but the motherfuckers that stand out are gonna be like, I mean, it's gonna be revolutionary. That's what happens right. when everybody has access. Like you see who's really talented.
Right.
So I'm excited about that.
Yeah, I agree.
I will say before we close the show, this or that, Transformers or Voltron?
Voltron all day. Let me.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Uh-huh. I got a lot of truth.
I mean, I knew you were going to say that. I just kind of wanted to hear the background.
Listen, and even instead of Voltron, which I love Voltron, I love old Transformers. Michael Bay just fucked up the Transformers.
Yeah.
People equate Transformers to the Michael Bay shit. But yeah, I'm like, no. that shit was garbage. Like, you got to go back to boxy Transformers.
Yes.
Even before that, for me, was Spectre Man and Ultraman. Yeah. And I'll take Ultraman over everything.
Okay.
Like between Transformers and Voltron, definitely Voltron.
What was the dude with the light on his chest? And every Ultraman. Show, Voltron? Yeah. Every Ultraman. Show. Every show he'd like run out of energy, and everybody would be like, "Ooh, the light is blinking. See, he better go recharge before this bad man gets him." And I'm like, and it was crazy because every week I'd be like, "Don't run out of energy."
Definitely, I just aged myself by saying Spectre Man, because nobody remembers that shit.
I have every episode of Spectre Man.
Yeah, you know what's crazy? So I worked at Tomy, they created Takara Tomy created Transformers. So while I was there, I got to meet the creator of Transformers.
Wow.
That's dope.
That's crazy.
It was crazy. He didn't speak a word of English, but it was like you could just feel a Transformer power, you know?
That's dope.
He was looking for Harold's.
Yeah, I should have took him home.
That was your end.
That was my end. I wasn't in that mind state back then.
I'm glad you are now, bro. It looks pretty
good. I mean, if you ever do like some straight up nerd podcast, let me know. I got a bunch of shit that I'm embarrassed to talk about. That I know. Information that I have.
Funny you should ask.
Funny, yeah. There you go. Let's talk after we're off the air. Yeah. Steve, thank you so much for man, this has been one of our longer shows in a while.
One of our best.
Oh, really? What's been one? Oh shit! That was 2 hours.
Yeah.
That's what happens.
I'll invoice you for the last hour.
And Risky is still unknown. So Risky is floating in the ether somewhere.
Yeah.
We miss you, buddy. Oh,
Steve, Steve, if people want to catch up on you or stay up to date with what you're doing, where can they keep up with you at?
You can find me at Carol's on 87.
If you do get that Harold's in Japan open, you got to be careful, because like when Ad 2 came on the show, he was parked outside of Harold's waiting for our show. He did this show on his phone because he was waiting to get it to Harold's.
Oh shit! what can people find? I don't know. Instagram, I guess. Instagram is Steve_Bravo. You want to hear something crazy? There are other Steve Bravos on Instagram, and we're all friends. So it's like multiverse Steve Bravo. One of them is a DJ from Mexico. It's weird. And me and this Steve Bravo have been friends since 2007 on Facebook. We've never met, but he always finds me on social media.
That's pretty dope.
So Steve_Bravo, and I'm on Facebook occasionally just saying the most random shit. That's also right. Steve Bravo. I have some other shit that I'm on, but I don't really use it that much. So I don't know.
What's your company Instagram?
Pop Toy Pop Art on Instagram. And the website is poptoypop.com. I'm still building it. It's hard to choose what you want to put on there, but I'm still building out poptoypop.com. That's also where you can get the Harold shirt from if you want it.
That might have to get got.
Which is, I don't even have one, so
don't get high on your own supply.
I can't.
Yeah, but I think you should get it now, because Steve is more than likely it's definitely a time limit for Steve, so he's not gonna want to look at it long. It's gonna be gone.
Like, I'm done with it.
Yeah, when he's done with it, he's done with it. So I try to tell people, like, yo, like, you see it, if Steve does it, get it now, for real.
Yeah. You know why? It's like, I don't, number one, you're right. I do get tired of things like really, really quickly, especially shit that I've seen, that I've made. I get tired of it really fast, and I'll try to make it go away really fast. Mm-hmm. Another thing, I have so much shit that I want to do that, once again, I can't do it all at the same time. I can't put it all out at the same time. I don't want to saturate it. I'm not holding on to shit like this is like this holy grail shit, like, oh, this is so special, you need this in your life shit. But it is special, and is you need this shit in your life. But I will get rid of that shit in a hot fucking second, and you will never see it again.
Yeah. And I think that's one of the best things about you, Steve. Like you do so, like your work is awesome, and it's not like it's limited.
It's weird. My work is weird. Like people look at you know what? Somebody was saying I don't want to keep everybody, but this is weird. It's like therapy for me because you know I don't even talk to many people. I don't talk a lot.
Sure don't.
But somebody pointed something out to me that I thought I was the only one that noticed. They're like, I look at what you make, and it looks like it's three or four different people making this shit because it's all like it doesn't look the same. It's different.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, there's nothing I can really do about that. And I think that's going to be my downfall is the fact that I don't have a signature. Like, it's just all my shit is random. It's just coming out of my brain. It's real randomly. Do you think that's going to be an issue?
No.
Like your opinion, will that be something that's going to hurt me down the line?
No. I don't.
I don't either.
I really don't.
Because I look at other artists and I'm like, you can tell, okay, they did this, all this stuff kind of fits in the same space. But I could do a show and I actually thought about doing this. I was going to do a show and come up with other different names, but it's just, and I think I can do that.
So do you think that you would come up with these names and then everything that looks like this, so you can, everything that looks like a certain thing goes under that name?
Yeah. Yeah. I already got the names too. I got the names picked out already.
So I think that's dope. Actually, I think that's dope as fuck. So
yeah, now I think that I said it, somebody else is going to do it.
Yeah.
Before me.
Or you just need to do it now and not trash it tomorrow because that's. He'd be like, I said it online. I'm not doing that shit. Somebody else is thinking it.
So that's real inside. So if you see a show and it's me with a bunch of people you never heard of, it's all me.
Yeah.
That's that.
Yeah, no, if anything, that's the fine line that you have to walk. Because if you have a signature style, then people are expecting that, and then you paint yourself in a corner and you limit yourself. Whereas if your brain operates in a way where things are different, then that's just the way that your brain operates, and people can come to you for a lot of different styles. That's the way I see it, because I'm a lot like you, where it just depends. Like sometimes I draw something that looks like the Peanuts, and sometimes I draw something that is far from that. So it all depends. But I mean, I can do it. So
somebody told me, yeah, just make what sells. I'm like,
that too. Okay.
Well, at this point, it's not much, so I guess I can just continue doing what I'm doing.
Well, I just bought a shirt, so.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. I saw that.
That was me.
Please allow 1 to 2 weeks for delivery.
No, actually,
you'll have it by, my guess is Saturday.
Cool.
What color did you get?
I got the black one because stains. Nice.
Yeah. But see, it's a Harold shirt. That's the thing. That's the beauty about the white Harold shirt. You can stain it with oil stains, and it's a fucking official.
Yeah. Yep.
See? Yeah. You gotta have like hand marks. That's another one, right? Like,
yeah.
You wipe your hands like this, you should put that on the design.
Yeah, I totally do not like white shirts. I'm getting that t-shirt in white.
That's what I was going back and forth with. Man. Yeah.
Yeah. You get it right.
I don't trust myself with white shirts.
All right. Sean Doe, where can people find you at?
People can find me at them Instagrams at DJ SEANDOE and Twitter's same thing. And Facebook under my name, Rasan Sean Doe Hawkins. And this weekend, if you choose to, if you're in the city of Chicago, please come out. Myself and Risky Business, we're doing MTV Gen video way back this weekend. So if you've been out, you know how fun that is. You know, it's an experience. We only do 80s and 90s. And now some of the thousands, but just kind of early thousands. But all video mixing, 21 foot screen at Emporium Park.
Can I say, as a fan and a friend, you guys need to do a better job about giving a heads up on these things?
Well, I mean, you got a week. Yeah,
they only do it every week.
Well, we do it once. But
they do it once. They do it once a month, and then like the once a week that I'm scrolling through a Facebook or something like that, then I see that it's in 2 days. Oh, that's great! I didn't know that.
Now you got 7.
Now, Chicago DJs are the worst at promoting. Like absolute worst. Historically.
Thanks, Questlove.
Carlos, where can people check you out at?
Hey, you can find me at coconutjustice.com, Coconut Justice everywhere else. And if you follow me on Instagram, you're going to see this.
Oh, that's me.
You just got buffed there, bro.
I mean, I gotta do it right. He doesn't talk to many people,
right?
So yeah. Oh, he doesn't talk to many people, so if I made fun of him, he probably wouldn't come out for his interview.
Keep on that. That looks dope.
Yeah, no,
I like the shoes look crazy. I like those.
I've been focused.
That's the size I wear.
No, that's the size I wear. Jesus Christ.
Okay. Easy.
For all the ladies. Gotta watch it. Size 13.
That's right.
And
searching for compliments still. Okay.
I'm going to close this out by saying you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at 278 Media. The number is 278 Media. And Midway, of course, is Midway Doc across the board. Check us out. Go to our YouTube page. Like our videos. Share our videos. Donate to us through PayPal. We're still paying for this thing out of pocket. But I think we all see a little light at the end of the tunnel, hopefully. So, yeah, until we are back next week. Are we back next week?
We are back next week, and our guest is Mr. Polly Think.
Oh, yeah.
Polly Think. Hey, you don't have sponsors. Yeah.
We don't actively seek them, but we kind of do.
You buy Pop Art Pop.
Actual Pop, yeah. I want to be a sponsor like Squarespace. This episode.
We do for some of our Midway things. We do have a sponsor in Shure Microphones, who provided us with a few podcasting mics and lavalier mics that we use in our interviews. So thank you to Shure. And yeah, so until next time, Steve, thanks a lot again for sitting with us for a wild night.
Oh man, thank you. I had fun. I enjoyed myself. I was a little worried because I don't, you know, I'm a hermit, so this is a little strange for me. But this is good. This is fun. I had fun. Thank
you. Awesome. Yeah.
Thank you. Man. I appreciate it.
All right, folks. Peace.
I was going to pull the plug, but I was like, wait a minute. I just want to make sure that. All right. See you guys next week.
Peace. Cool.